earthquake in Taiwan, an unusually cold Olympics, and a drone invention that could save lives are all ahead today on CNN 10. I'm Carl Azus at the CNN Center. We're starting on an island that borders the East China Sea, where a magnitude 6.4 earthquake struck late on Tuesday. One city in Taiwan that was hit really hard was Hualien. It's on the northeast coast of the island, and it's where at least 8 people were killed and 262 others were injured. Many people are spending the night outside for fear their homes aren't safe to sleep in. Dozens of aftershocks have hit the area, and an estimated 35,000 people have no running water. This isn't the deadliest earthquake to hit Taiwan. 40 people were killed in 2016 when a magnitude 6.4 quake struck the island, and 2,400 people died in 1999 after a magnitude 7.3 tremor. Taiwan is on the Pacific Ring of Fire, a horseshoe-shaped area that runs around the edge of the Pacific Ocean. Earthquakes and volcanoes are common from Chile to Indonesia. Still, residents say their nerves are frayed. Dangerously tilting buildings have become symbols of how destructive earthquakes can be. Taiwan's government says hundreds of military troops and firefighters are helping with the rescue effort.
Dramatic scenes of devastation from Taiwan after a major earthquake overnight. Now, the 6.4 magnitude quake struck late on Tuesday night just off the east coast of Taiwan near Hualien County. Rescue crews are racing to save lives. In fact, 236 people have been rescued so far. Now, the president of Taiwan, Tsai Ing-wen, took to Twitter earlier to thank first responders, saying this, quote, "Thank you to our first responders for their tireless efforts in Hualien. Rescue operations have been continuing night and day. Right now, 145 people remain unaccounted for. We will not rest until all are found." Now, again, that tweet was sent a few hours ago. The number of unaccounted for now stands at 85. Now, at least 4 buildings in the quake zone are tilting or already collapsed, and we are keeping a close eye on the Marshall Hotel, the Beauty Inn, and the Yun Men Sui Ti building, all in downtown Hualien. This is where rescue workers are scrambling to find any additional survivors. Now, to save lives, rescue workers are racing against time. They're also racing against the danger of more aftershocks. In fact, a 5.4 magnitude aftershock hit near Hualien shortly after the larger quake. Christy Liu Stout, CNN, Hong Kong.
Moving north from Taiwan to where the 2018 Olympic Winter Games are just a day away. It's cold. Pyeongchang, South Korea is surrounded by mountains. The forecast for the day of the opening ceremonies predicts high temperatures will be around 42 degrees Fahrenheit, but a plunge to the 20s during the day and the teens at night follows before things warm up a little next week. This could be one of the coldest Winter Olympics in history. The Reuters news agency says in training runs, extremely cold snow has warped some athletes' skis, forcing coaches to throw them away. You'd think that this means there'd be plenty of natural snow on the ground, but February is a very dry month in Pyeongchang.
Snowmaking started early in South Korea this season. October saw the first artificial snow hit the ski slopes, and it hasn't stopped since.
Pyeongchang certainly doesn't have the same problem that Sochi in Russia had 4 years ago. Any natural snow that falls here is going to stay on the ground. It is cold enough. But the issue is there's just simply not that much natural snow. After all, winter in Korea is the dry season.
Yeah, at least 5 actually before that too.
Ian Honey is the project manager for SMI Snowmakers. His company has already made snow for 5 Winter Olympics. He started preparing for Pyeongchang 3 years ago.
Here it's all 100% man-made snow. We've had great temperatures. We've been really lucky.
So none of this is natural snow then?
98% would be man-made.
This has been the scene for months in Pyeongchang, mountainsides wrapped in a mist of man-made snow. So how do you actually make it?
We're doing very similar to what Mother Nature does. We're taking water and we're forcing it into the atmosphere, and we're generating a crystalline structure. But the structure that we'll generate is a more consistent structure. They're all the same. Where natural snow is, every flake is different.
Tourists don't seem to mind the snow's man-made, enjoying a last peaceful day on the slopes before the games begin. As for which is better, natural or artificial, these two ski instructors say there's no contest.
Artificial snow is good for skiing more than because we can more speeding. They're really good.
And speed is what Olympic athletes want. We'll no doubt hear soon enough whether they approve of Pyeongchang's snow. There have been some heavy snowfalls in recent months. A few weeks ago, there was a rush to preserve the snow after it fell, carving it into massive blocks. We now see why, as the snow festival opens, massive sculptures towering over children who are more interested in the snow than the art. So while it may not always look like the winter wonderland you'd expect from a Winter Olympics, the organisers say they're ready, let the games begin. Paula Hancock's CNN, Pyeongchang, South Korea.
10-second trivia. Which of these scientists is famous for inventing a telegraph system? Thomas Edison, Alexander Graham Bell, Samuel Morse, or Johannes Gutenberg? Samuel Morse, the namesake of Morse code, invented an electric telegraph system in the early 1830s. It's hard to pinpoint exactly when the first drones were invented and put to use. Some say that unmanned balloons that were filled with bombs and put in combat in the mid-1800s were the first types of drones, but they weren't really remotely operated. They depended on the wind to get them to their intended target, and that didn't always happen. Of course, in this century, uses for drones go far beyond war to include surveillance, exploration, photography, racing. And one young inventor is hoping that smart drones will be able to navigate dangerous places, avoiding obstacles while searching for survivors.
I'm Mihir Garamella. I'm 18 years old, and I'm a student at Stanford University in California. I'm building autonomous drones that can navigate and carry out critical missions in indoor spaces, and I hope one day these drones can help save lives. I've always been curious about how things work, and then sort of using that curiosity to actually build things to solve problems. When I was 14, I won the Google Science Fair for building a fruit fly-inspired drone that could help first responders carry out search and rescue missions. It all started with bananas. 4 years ago, my family went to India on vacation, and when we got back, we realized that we left some bananas on the kitchen counter, and by that point, they were rotting, so our house was filled with fruit flies. I kept trying to spot them, kept getting really mad when they kept escaping, but I also became curious how these tiny organisms, tiny brain, really bad eyesight, how could they possibly escape so effectively? So fruit flies can't see in very much detail, but that means that they can process what they can see and respond to that really quickly. Fruit flies actually have the fastest visual system on the planet. They can see 10 times faster than humans can. Around the same time, drones were just starting to become popular. I also realized that they could have tremendous potential to actually save lives. But the problem is that they aren't really good at reacting to their environments. And so I wanted to see whether we could draw this instinct from the fruit fly that enables them to escape so effectively to make drones good at responding to their environments. And this is something called biomimicry, so looking to biology for models on how to design these solutions to really complex engineering problems. Birds actually see using the images from each eye separately. And so that's similar to how we want to do this with just a single camera. Fruit flies see in terms of edges. And so I designed an algorithm that could sort of use both of those cues to process a stream from a single camera and make a map of a 3D environment that it could then use to avoid obstacles. So what I'm trying to build now is this intelligent drone platform that can be used for search and rescue, construction, industrial inspection, inspecting power plants, all of these applications to sort of carry out these really critical life-saving missions. So the idea is that you take this drone, plug in different sensors based on whatever task you're trying to accomplish, and the drone would use those sensors to carry out a certain mission. They can tell first responders the locations of trapped victims after an earthquake. They can detect rust in bridges or other infrastructure to prevent collapse. They could go into a nuclear power plant, pinpoint hotspots of radiation, and say, you know, these tanks are going to leak or these tanks are leaking because of these reasons. My dream is to build something that can improve the lives of a billion people. Success for me is these drones, really saving lives.
Getting back to winter sports, not everyone can safely step in skis and sail down snowy slopes at more than 60 miles per hour. But dozens of folks recently did take a seat on a shovel and hurtle downhill at about the same speed at the World Championship Shovel Race. It's an annual event at the Angel Fire Resort in New Mexico. Costs between $20 and $70 to enter, depending on your age and skill level. And whether or not they finish seated upright, every competitor there got to shovel snow. Hey, at least they had a handle on the challenge. They were on the cutting edge of racing. They competed at blading speeds. This is CNN 10, where you know we've got the scoop on shovel puns. I'm Carl Azuz.